Olá, meus amigos, bem-vindos a mais uma edição do programa Os Portugueses do Val. É com muito gosto que estamos na vossa companhia e aqui estaremos durante os próximos 30 minutos falando sobre as vivências portuguesas e luso-descendentes neste vastíssimo Vale de São Joaquim, no estado da Califórnia e um pouco também pelos Estados Unidos da América. Este é o quarto e último programa que dedicamos à convenção inaugural da PALCUS, Portuguese American Leadership Council of the United States, uma organização nacional com sede junto da capital dos Estados Unidos da América e que teve em junho deste ano de 2018, como aqui já referimos, portanto, uma convenção nacional de líderes portugueses e luso-descendentes das nossas comunidades em vários estados da União Americana. Dentro de alguns minutos, dentro de cerca de 7 minutos, vamos estar com o quarto e último programa. Estes programas têm sido, portanto, a parte que é da convenção em inglês, porque a convenção foi toda em inglês, uma vez que a maioria dos participantes, apesar de ser de origem portuguesa, aliás todos de origem portuguesa, mas muitos já de segundas e terceiras gerações que não falam português, mas que têm um grande interesse na sua presença portuguesa, na sua identidade portuguesa e na presença portuguesa aqui no mundo norte-americano. Há muitas organizações, quer sejam locais, quer sejam regionais, quer sejam estaduais e, neste caso, nacional, como a PALCUS, que, apesar de já falarem em inglês, apesar das suas atas, de tudo o que existe no seu mundo, no seu património, ser no idioma inglês, existem porque existe uma comunidade de origem portuguesa, quer nos Estados da América, quer nesse estado, quer nessa região, quer nesse condado, quer nessa cidade onde essas organizações são sediadas. Há outras, eu relembro aqui, por exemplo, a Fundação Luso-Americana, portanto, que é a Luso-American Education Foundation. Também tudo é no idioma inglês, praticamente. O Clube Cabrilho, que é uma organização muito querida dos portugueses aqui no estado da Califórnia, também todas as suas atividades são em inglês. Portanto, cada vez mais é por onde o mundo vai, mas mesmo assim, organizações como a PALCUS e como a nível local, o Clube Cabrilho, como a Luso-American Education Foundation e tantas outras, a PFSA, portanto, a Portuguese Fraternal Society of America, apesar de muitos dos seus eventos serem também em inglês, mas continuam a lutar para que nas nossas escolas, no nosso movimento associativo, hajam, portanto, aulas de língua e cultura portuguesas para as nossas crianças e para os nossos jovens. É importante e é cada vez mais importante que continuemos a apostar na criação de novos cursos de língua e cultura portuguesas aqui no estado da Califórnia e um pouco por toda a União Americana. Antes de irmos para Washington, D.C., para este quarto e último programa, eu queria vos falar um pouco sobre isso mesmo, o ensino da língua e cultura portuguesas aqui no estado da Califórnia, mais em concreto. É que neste ano, que já começou, portanto, há vários meses, o ano letivo começou nas escolas públicas nos fins de meados para fins de agosto e nas escolas privadas, nas escolas ligadas ao nosso movimento associativo, como todos nós sabemos, as aulas começaram no princípio ou meados de setembro. Portanto, já há várias semanas, e há alguns casos no ensino público há meses, que temos as aulas e o ano letivo em curso. E neste ano letivo, incluindo as escolas privadas, as escolas do nosso movimento associativo e as escolas públicas, temos um aumento de quase 20%, exatamente, quase 20% no número de alunos a aprenderem a língua e cultura portuguesas aqui no estado da Califórnia. Isso é de facto importante e isso é de facto impressionante para a nossa comunidade. Ainda bem, ainda estamos muito aquém. Portanto, temos 3.451 escolas do ensino secundário americano, portanto, no estado da Califórnia. 3.400 escolas. E estamos em apenas 11 escolas. Portanto, ainda temos um bocado para chegar lá. Ainda temos pelo menos mais umas 1000 escolas que deveriam ter o ensino da língua e cultura portuguesas. Mas 11 é muito melhor das 9 que tivemos durante muitos anos e das 7 que tivemos, ou aliás 6, quando eu comecei a dar aulas no ensino secundário, que foi, como eu disse, há 23 anos atrás, porque como os nossos amigos telespectadores sabem, eu aposentei-me de dar aulas do ensino secundário neste último ano letivo, em junho deste ano 2018. Estou neste momento a dar uma aula, um curso, portanto, na Universidade Estadual da Califórnia, em Fresno, e conto a partir de janeiro também estar de novo, onde estive durante 17 anos, no College of the Sequoias e, quem sabe, também em outros sistemas do ensino universitário, do ensino superior. Mas, há 23 anos, quando eu comecei a dar aulas, apenas estavam a dar aulas 7 escolas do ensino secundário. Neste momento estamos com 11, com a possibilidade de termos mais 2 ou 3 nos próximos anos letivo. Aliás, a comunidade de Ceras, no norte da Califórnia, mais concretamente no norte do Vale de São Joaquim, junto da cidade de Modesto, começou, portanto, com 2 professoras, cursos de língua portuguesa e, neste primeiro ano, já tem 270 alunos nas 2 escolas a aprenderem a língua e cultura portuguesas. Em San Diego, o Point Loma High School, que há 3 anos começou apenas com 30 e poucos alunos a aprender português, neste momento já tem, portanto, está a dar 4 turmas diferentes, tem 4 turmas diferentes de português 1, 2 e 3, e com cerca de 128 alunos. Em Tular, os 3 colegas que estão a dar português continuam com números, particularmente o Mission Oak High School, onde está o meu amigo Clemente Fagundes, teve um crescimento, portanto, bastante significativo dos 125, 130 alunos que normalmente estavam naquela escola a aprender português neste ano letivo, quase 160, portanto um acréscimo também de 20% e tal. E as outras 2 escolas, a Tular Western e a Tular Union, onde eu dei aulas durante 22 anos, também mantêm os mesmos números de há anos passados. E outras escolas, no nosso movimento associativo, em Turlock, a escola Jorge de Sena teve um acréscimo. Outras escolas novas, em Mantica, foi criada uma escola nova. Em Tracy, criada uma escola nova. Escolas também novas em São Paulo, no norte da Califórnia, em Livermore, etc. Portanto, há um grande movimento para o aumento de cursos de língua e cultura portuguesas. Portanto, para vos dizer que nem tudo está perdido, meus amigos, é verdade que talvez falemos menos português em casa, nas nossas famílias, mas há muitos dos nossos filhos, dos nossos netos e, em algum caso, dos nossos telespectadores mais idosos, alguns dos vossos bisnetos, também a aprenderem português. Isso é muito bom. Gostaríamos, aqui no centro da Califórnia, de ver escolas portuguesas em Hanford, em Livermore. Os Community College, o West Hills, deveria ter português. O Ridley College também deveria ter português. Deveríamos ter português também no nosso movimento associativo. Era importante termos escolas portuguesas também nas nossas instituições de Hanford, de Livermore, de Riverdale, de Layton, de Fresno, aqui de Easton, mais ao norte, em Mercedes, em Dos Palos, etc. Portanto, vamos lá continuar com este movimento e vamos aumentar cada vez mais o número de alunos. Portanto, os nossos filhos, no meu caso, não é o meu caso, os meus filhos, graças a Deus, ainda falam português, apesar de não comunicarem português todos os dias, porque estão muito mais, obviamente, como os vossos também, no mundo americano, mas ainda falam português. Mas muitos, nos nossos casos, em muitos nossos casos, já os nossos filhos, netos e bisnetos não falam português. Mas com aulas podem aprender-se a falar português. Se não a comunicarem 100%, podem aprender a falar algum português e aprendem muito sobre a geografia, a história, a cultura, as tradições, os usos e costumes da nossa terra e das nossas gentes, para além da presença da nossa história de vivências portuguesas em terras americanas. E falando em vivências portuguesas em terras americanas, vamos então até Washington, D.C., com o 4º e último programa, portanto, em inglês, mas o 4º e último programa da convenção anual e a primeira, a inaugural, que foi em junho deste ano de 2018, da Palcos, Portuguese American Leadership Council of the United States. E mais uma vez, convido-vos a irem até, portanto, à internet, palcos.org, palcos.org, para serem membros desta organização que está ao serviço da nossa comunidade de origem portuguesa aqui em todos os Estados Unidos da América, servindo todos os Estados da União Americana, a convenção anual que aconteceu em junho da Palcos e o Canal 49, os Portugueses no Val, dedicam este 4º e último programa.
In terms of getting elected into office, what do candidates need? And from my research and also from what was said here today, you need an organization. But if, of course, this depends on what type of electoral system exists in the jurisdiction where you are running. Is it a blue state, a red state, a purple state? Is it partisan or non-partisan elections? If it is partisan elections, you have the party as a political organization already established that can provide you with support. But if you are running in non-partisan elections, which most of the municipal elections in the United States are non-partisan, then you need to create your own organization. And most candidates that I have, and officials that I have spoken to, the first thing they say is, I start with family. And our panelists said that as well. Family and friends. And you start building your own organization. You can't run a campaign by yourself. You need to have an organization to help you, to fundraise for you, to promote you. And then you also need then to reach out to the community organizations, and that was mentioned here as well. And it was also mentioned that those organizations really need to come together and collaborate and get behind our candidates, people that declare that they are running for office. So in addition to that, you need money. How do you spell power? M-O-N-E-Y. And so there's got to be a way to raise the resources, and you're going to raise resources from family, from friends, from the wealthy people in your community. You have to go shake a lot of hands and kiss a lot of babies, and hopefully people give you money. But as a community, we could also do better and find ways of channeling money to our candidates. I'm sorry to say, but you need money to win elections in this country. And New York has started a PAC, which I think it's a great idea. New York is on the cutting edge of mobilizing the Portuguese-American community there. And so creating additional PACs. And once you create a PAC, then you need to define what it is that the candidates that you are going to support should stand for. And then that was what our second question was about, what is the Portuguese-American political agenda? And of course, we talked about Lages and the role of the Atlantic and Portugal's strategic place in the Atlantic and the importance to the United States. We also have been talking about the promotion of the Portuguese language in the United States. But the survey that we did shows some issues. We have an aging population, and so any policy that is directed at the welfare and well-being of the Portuguese of the elderly population is a Portuguese-American issue. So other issues like water in California, that's not a Portuguese-American issue. But it is a Portuguese-American issue when we have such a large population of farmers in California. So what else is out there that we can identify as issues? And they're going to vary from state to state and from political jurisdiction to political jurisdiction, that then we can advocate along the political sphere for the Portuguese American. These are American issues that are important to the Portuguese American community. You know, another issue that comes to mind that has been in the news recently is the minority status of Portuguese-American businesses. Is that something that we should be advocating for because in some places we are no longer considered a minority or to have a minority status? Is that important for Portuguese businesses to continue to have minority status and benefit from the set-asides that exist for minority businesses? And there are other issues, so an agenda item, an action item, is to identify the issues. In terms of the future and the movement of the Portuguese-American population from area to area, I think an agenda item you'd also be to find out you know, who is in Colorado? Do they have an established Portuguese-American community there? Do they have churches? Do they have clubs? We know that to run for office, you got to go to the churches, you got to go to the clubs, you got to reach out to these organizations where you can get votes. I mean, churches generally don't support a political candidate, but your voters are there.
I will start with the first note that I thought all panelists in the Building the Social Capital mentioned, which was show and tell. We need to show more of who we are and what we do. We need to tell more who we are and what we do. The number two point had to do with intergenerational relationship, how different generations can converge in the same organization. And there was a sense that change can have, turning down ideas can actually turn people out of the organization, and so instead have a different approach to new ideas, or at least asking the elders of the organizations to have a different approach to new ideas, but also on the young folks, on the youth, to also take that in mind as they are presenting new ideas to the organizations. Be patient. So the patience was not a word presented, but that's what I read. Bring ideas, new ideas in slowly, and implement them slowly as well. Number three on my notes, very interesting point, ask your members. Let's ask our members, what do we think about the paths of our organizations, and where do we want to go? We saw that with Anthony Pugh, who said, after participating in this event, this is what I am going to do in my own organization, the Luso-American Financial. I'm going to do a survey. I'm going to ask our members, what is it that we want to do in the future, thinking about the future? As number four, I think we saw an interesting display of ethnic boundaries, even among our different civic organizations, or the speakers in the two first panels had at least felt the need to identify their regional boundary up front. That was interesting as well, to see that replicated here. Number four on my list, there was an interesting question by Dinis Borges about professionalization, and then also an interesting response on what does it mean for a volunteer organization to professionalize? Does that even make sense? Is that possible? What makes sense? What does not make sense? So an interesting question for each organization. The last point that Dulce and Denise were just discussing has to do with building alliances. That was also building alliances with other ethnic organizations. That was also a point in our panel. In order to build coalitions. So the sense that, or the idea that our individual organizations need to continue to build coalition. Whether it be regional coalition, national coalition, across ethnicities, coalition needs to happen. And I will the mentoring also, of course, we saw the example of PAPS that places a very strong emphasis on mentoring. But the other organizations mentioned that as well. And finally, I will end with the last thought that I have in my notes, which has to do with volunteerism and volunteer organizations, the fact that we will not do what we do not value and what we do not support. So volunteer organizations follow the desires, the needs of their membership. And will continue to do so.
We also have 386 teachers, 161 schools, and 648 courses of Portuguese language, like envisioned by our office in the U.S. Finally, we have at least 10 million students from K to 12 foreign language enrollment in the United States. And this shows that the numbers are growing according to American Councils for International Education. So an estimated of 10 million students are expected to learn foreign languages in various schools across America. Regarding the renewal, and this is the solutions or future outlook that we envision, and also the Portuguese government, our Minister of Foreign Affairs and our embassy have been instrumental, like I said, on this new cooperation with American councils, is the signature of a memorandum of understanding that happened in January. Our ambassador signed this memorandum and allow us to bring a partnership with American councils toward promotion of Portuguese language. We've distributed a recent flyer with American councils, bilingual flyer, that explains a little bit of this partnership, that this year we quadruplicate the numbers of students that enrolled the exam, which is very significant. Just for all of you that you're not aware of this matter, I would like to explain you one thing. Before, students in the United States study Portuguese basically, and they would never get any credits for higher education or for nothing, let's say. Since 2017, through this examination and this certification, all the students that apply to this exam in the high schools of the United States, in every state, and this year we made possible to have 16 centers around the country, which is a big achievement, especially in New Jersey, Massachusetts, Florida, New York, Georgia, and Ohio, but of course with a big incidence in New Jersey and Massachusetts, because that's where our office of the Camões Institute are present, so we have a more closer relationship with those school districts, and at least 250 students did the exam, and some of them got a scholarship or grant from the Camões Institute provided by the Camões Institute, and this was a grant of $4,000 that went to pay the fees of the students that couldn't afford the total of the exam. So it's a big achievement, and I'll stop by here. Thank you. There was a lot of things to be told, but I will close my remarks. Thank you so much.
Good afternoon. I was asked to talk about Portuguese education programs or Portuguese programs in U.S. higher education. The most recent official data compiled by the Modern Language Association for the fall semester of 2016 shows that a total of 9,827 students enrolled in Portuguese courses at 125 American colleges and universities across the nation, except only for 8 states.
Immediate action item I think all of us can execute on immediately, even right here with our phones, is to share some of the information that we have either talked about today, or if you know about a program, an internship program, an exchange program, resources from the Instituto Camões, anything like that that is already existing, it's up to us to share it. And we all have networks. We all have, you know, either Facebook or Twitter or email lists or whatever it is. And we need to make that kind of information go viral within our community, because that's really the only way that people find out about it. I can't tell you how many times, you know, PALCAS has sent out a newsletter and I've emailed a bunch of people about a program or a scholarship program, internship program, and then you meet somebody that says, I had no idea, and you're like, like, how do we reach everybody that needs to find out about this information? The idea of the exchange of the sort of the encontro idea that this gentleman had here. You know, the Portuguese government has an encontro de jovens that they've been doing for years, but not everybody knows about it, and I don't know if they're still doing it or not, but even I went on one, and it was fantastic. And as Denise mentioned, the Instituto Camões has a ton of resources already with online curriculum. We need to share it. So an immediate action item I would ask all of you is to share this information with your networks, with your students, with your families, everybody that you know that would be interested. So this concludes our program for today. I do have one announcement. Oh, here it is. If you are going to be here in the Virginia area, the Virginia Portuguese Community Center invites everybody to be present on the 26th at 6 p.m. At their community center in Manassas to welcome President Marcelo Rebelo de Sousa for food and drinks. It's complimentary, just 6 p.m. at the Manassas Center. You can Google it and find the address and go meet Marcelo and take a selfie. So. But as I mentioned, the work doesn't end here. We will be creating a final report, as we've talked about. All these ideas that have been mentioned here will be put into this report, including additional ideas that we brainstorm as a board, as a community. If you go home and you're talking with friends and family and you come up with an idea, please email us. We will include it in the report. Again, the idea is for us to share this report, have some ideas, everybody can look at it and maybe pick out one or two ideas that they can implement in their community, in their school, in their club, whatever it is. So there's actual, you know, real work and action items that is going to come out of today. If you don't have our email address, you can go to our website and it's right there, but it's very easy. It's palcus@palcus.org. So very easy to remember. Also, I wouldn't be doing my job as chair of Palcus if I didn't encourage you all to become members. And join us in our mission to be the national voice that advocates for and promotes the advancement of the Portuguese American community economically, professionally, culturally, and politically. We have launched some major initiatives such as the Make Portuguese Count campaign that Marie mentioned for the U.S. Census 2020, the Politicus podcast, which has also been mentioned today to encourage civic participation, and more Portuguese running for office, the Palcus Index National Survey, and a national database of Portuguese American and elected officials, which is very similar to your idea, that will be online eventually. We do all of this with an all-volunteer board, and I will say that again, an all-volunteer board, and we have one paid staffer that sits in Manassas, and I think we are able to accomplish a heck of a lot with the limited resources that we have. And we do have the support of foundations such as FLAD, which we are eternally grateful for, and the Portuguese government, so thank you very much. We need your support for the membership, though, to help us continue these initiatives and more. So if you're still on the fence about whether or not to become a member, I just ask that you do one thing. Go to our website, look at the programs that we have, and really I hope that you will be impressed with what we were able to do and accomplish with the limited resources that we have, and even find a way for you to participate, whether that's becoming a mentor, because we do have an online mentoring program, whether that's hosting a business mixer in your local area. There's a lot of ways to get involved.
E assim, meus amigos, estivemos com o quarto e o último programa, que foi em inglês, dedicado, portanto, à Organização Nacional Palcus e à sua convenção, a convenção inaugural, que ocorreu em Washington, D.C., na capital dos Estados da América, e que teve o apoio da Fundação Luso-Americana para o Desenvolvimento, uma fundação que muito tem contribuído para a presença portuguesa no mundo americano e para os intercâmbios entre Portugal e os Estados Unidos e vice-versa, e também, obviamente, nas relações bilaterais entre os nossos dois países. A Fundação Luso-Americana para o Desenvolvimento, FLAD, é uma fundação instrumental para o relacionamento Portugal-Estados Unidos e parabéns particularmente à sua atual direção, dirigida pelo professor Dr. Vasco Rato, que tem tido um papel predominante na aproximação das nossas comunidades ao mundo americano e das nossas comunidades também ao mundo atual português. Foi com muito gosto que estivemos na vossa companhia. Até sempre, o programa Os Portugueses no Val, consigo.